Good morning and happy Father's Day to you all you fathers out there, and thank you for coming and visiting with us today or for coming regularly. We appreciate that. I wanted to point out something to you really quickly. If you will look into the handout of your bulletin, you'll see that there is a QR code. We ask that as you listen to these announcements this morning that you take out your cell phone. It's the only time that we ask that of you, to take out your cell phone. No, I'm just kidding. But if you will take out your cell phone, scan that QR code, and let us know that you're here, we greatly appreciate that. So as I ramble on, you'll have plenty of time, I promise. All right? I was thinking about it, but
why don't you tell people what it is?
Right now, we're here.
Just anytime.
So, Dr. Mosser wanted me to point out to you that today is the day that we are returning our baby bottles filled with coin or any other material that is valuable. Okay, so anytime, if you want to bring that up to the altar up here, you can do that during the offertory, or you can do it this morning right now if you brought them as I'm saying the announcement. So you are welcome as I continue on to bring your baby bottles up here to the altar, and we will bless those later on. The book study, Good Enough, by Kate Bowler and Jessica Ritchie, will continue to meet starting on, it's already starting, but it will be on June 21st, that's a Tuesday, at 6 p.m. in room 117. So make sure you come join that book study. It should be incredibly good for your heart and soul. So please continue to join that. The Children's Ministry Summer Hangout Space Jam at the Beltonian this Wednesday. So we want to make sure that we announce that and make sure that the kids get there. I love Space Jam, but that's a me thing. But if the children want to come, that'd be great. And that's at 4 p.m. on June 22nd. 4 p.m. June 22nd for Space Jam. Youth 412 Summer Olympics is continuing with one of my favorite games of all time, a Smash Brothers tournament. I will be there.
Be there.
And I will win. All right, so that is also on June 22nd from 6 to 8 p.m. Okay, so that's at the YAC. We are coming up, y'all, on VBS. And I'm so excited. I know that Kristen is excited. Our children's ministry team is excited. That is going to be, what does it say there, June 27th through the 30th. So that's next week, not this upcoming week, but the following week from 9:30 a.m. to 12 p.m. Okay, so registration is still open. We want you guys to come and be a part of that. And then there is always still a need for families to come and join us. And so we need greeters, and we will need snacks. So there's always that open availability for help. So welcome to Salado United Methodist Church. Thank you for being here with us, and if you're a guest with us, we especially want to welcome you, and we're going to continue on with our worship this morning.
Since our greeting time last week was such an outstanding success, I'd like for everybody to stay to greet their neighbors.
Good morning.
way back to your seats and then stand where you are. We're going to continue on with singing our first hymn, Rock of Ages, Cleft for Me. I will speak first, and then you will join in with me. There is one God, and there is one mediator, Christ Jesus, who came as a ransom for all, to whom we testify. This saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance, that Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners, and was manifested in the flesh, vindicated in the spirit, seen by angels, proclaimed among the nations, believed in throughout the world, taken up in glory. Great indeed is the mystery of the gospel. Amen.
Glory be to the Father. We have some prayer concerns that I want to share today. First of all, many of you have known Elizabeth or Betty Shepherd for a long, long time, and she passed away this week, and I know that she was friends with some of you, and I don't really know what to do with this because, you know, I knew her, but her family, you know, it's from all over the place. I'm trying to remember where Bettina is from, either San Antonio or Houston. And her son is from Arizona, I believe. And the family has requested that we do the funeral this afternoon at 3 o'clock. And they said it would be a kind of a private family affair. So I'm not telling you not to come. That's all. Something else. We've had an explosion of grandchildren this week. As you can see, we have flowers on the altar, and the notice is there, but we want to congratulate the McLeods. Are they sitting in the normal place? No, they are not. But they have a new grandchild, and so we're very proud of them, even though they had nothing to do with it. And then Tammy Bass has a new grandchild that I found out about this morning. And so we want to say prayers of congratulations to them. We have, several folks in our church that are under the weather and so forth. Some people are traveling about the country right now, and I see some of you that I haven't seen for a few weeks, so I'm glad that you came back and that you're with us this morning. So do we have any other prayer concerns that we need to share? First, should I say something about your wonderful lawn mowing skills?
No, thanks.
Okay. He helped a family in our church this week and is really embarrassed about it, so I thought I would bring it up. Let's go to God in prayer. Gracious and merciful God, we ask that as we pray silently to you, that you would hear the prayers of our hearts. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for your deliverance of us from sin and death. Sin enters into all human relationships because it is a separation that occurs between us and other people, between us and you. We ask that you might help us bridge that gap, and so that we might be the people you created us to be. Help us bind ourselves to one another. We ask that we might practice forgiveness with our church members that we feel have disappointed us. We ask you to restore our fortunes like they were before. We ask that as we are thinking that we are over this COVID business, that we truly are over it. But we ask you to protect us from this pernicious disease. Remind us, Lord, that when we do works or missions and forget you, that we have succumbed to pride, which tends to divide us, make us people that we do not want to be. Remind us that when you build something, that you use our hands, but it is still your vision and your skill that
make certain that our anxious toil will come to fruition in something creative and useful for our brothers and sisters. We ask you to continue to bless us, especially our church, in the things that we do in this community, this village of Salado, Texas. We ask you to watch over those who make leadership decisions on our behalf. And we ask that you would continue to guide us, to guard us, and to gird our loins so that we might do your work in our world. We pray congratulations for those persons who have added to their families this week. We ask your blessings upon the family that has lost one of its loved ones. All that we say, do keep us in your care. In the name of Jesus Christ, who taught his disciples to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. I'd like to invite the children, if they would like to come down and see Miss Beth today. You guys don't be too rough on her, okay?
And I want you to think really hard of something, some way that your dad makes you smile. And when you think of it, smile. All right. Well, then I'm going to go on from here. It is Father's Day, right? Yes. I'm going to say Happy Father's Day. All right. Well, in our house, my kids, when they were growing up, we had heard a lot of dad jokes. Do y'all hear a lot of dad jokes? No? Well, let me tell you, they're the best. You know why? Because they're not funny. Okay. What happens is, when they would say, "Tell us a joke, Dad," it was really a request for a groan-inducing, pun-heavy, not really very funny, but we laugh anyway, known culturally as a dad joke. And we all know a dad joke when we hear it because, well, here's an example. What did the ocean say to the beach? Nothing. It just waved. What did the baby corn say to the mama corn?
Where's popcorn?
Yes! You got it. Where's popcorn? It just was popcorn. Where do you go to learn how to make a banana split? Sunday school. See, those are all dad jokes. They're not that funny, but they kind of make us smile. Parents have to do hard work and things each day that make them sometimes grumpy or sometimes happy. But they do some things really well sometimes, and sometimes they make mistakes, like because they're human. We need to forgive them as our Father in heaven forgives us. Jesus taught us to pray to the Father in heaven, because our Father in heaven is perfect, and God does not make mistakes. Remember, God delights in each of us, in each of you, as his beloved child. No matter what you've done or failed to do, you are delightful, and you bring God joy by being the person that God created you to be. Now, that is not a joke. So today, let's remember our dads, okay? They may not always get those jokes right, but they make us smile anyway. Oh, and one more joke. And I thought of this earlier because we met as a choir. See how tiny the choir is? Mr. Terry was calling it a mini choir. The real reason why they call it a mini choir is because there's not very many. Let us pray. Ready? Dear Father in heaven, we thank you for our dads. We ask you to keep them safe. In Jesus we pray. Amen.
As the kids get their treat and head back to the seat, can we all stand together as we continue to praise and worship, singing, "Great is thy faithfulness." Let's sing this together.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy
share some good news, which is related to the offering, so it'll take me a minute to get there. So is that good, David?
Oh, I think tomorrow.
All right. Well, David went to annual conference this week, where, you know, all the Methodists.
Not good.
The good news was I didn't have to go, because I don't have to go yet, but someday I will. But I heard that in typical church fashion, we formed a committee to do something. That's what churches do, right? But this committee is looking at restoring something that's very important and near and dear to my heart, which is our Conference Council on Youth Ministry and our conference mission trips, which were cut a couple of years ago due to a variety of reasons. And I'm very excited and overjoyed because we've been praying for that, because I served on the executive committee of that. I see some of our students here today who have served on those committees. And it just reminds me, as we come to this time of offering, just how much our offerings spread out across our conference. It's not just here in our church, but the money that we take in, that we pay for our conference, helps support all of those ministries and all of those connections so that our youth and students can learn together and grow together and serve together. And I am just overjoyed that our conference has decided to explore ways of restoring funding to that and getting those things rolling again. So I don't know, I was just overjoyed to hear that news. And I know good news usually doesn't come out of annual conference, but to me that was great news. So as we come through our time of offering today, we want to remember that the reach of what we do and how it affects not just our community, but those across the state. So if you would please pray for me as we bless our offerings this morning. Healing Father, please use these gifts that we are giving to mend the hearts of those who have been possessed by earthly things. You have the ability to mend our insecurities, our greed, our self-indulgence, our prejudice, and our fear. You alone nurture our souls. So may this worship this morning and our gifts renew our desire to follow you and to reject the forces of evil and to remember our baptism. And may we continue to grow closer to you as we serve the world and those that you love. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who restores and reconciles all who believe in him, we pray. Amen. Thank you.
today, of course, is Father's Day, and I suggested to somebody on our staff that we get all of the fathers' roses like we do the mothers for Mother's Day. No one seemed to be very enthusiastic about that particular idea. Not that they ever are, but I do my best. Our morning lesson today is kind of an odd one because it is so much out of a first century culture that when we're talking about understanding it as 21st century people, it's kind of difficult. Context is different and so forth. So I want to offer an insight about studying the Bible. You can, if you don't go to Sunday school, you can count this part of the sermon as a Sunday school lesson if you would like. But it helps us think about the relationship between us and the Bible that we too often neglect. The guy that wrote what I'm going to read to you now is named Richard Rohrbaugh, and he puts it this way. We must begin, therefore, with a plain fact we have rarely allowed ourselves to acknowledge. No biblical writer had modern Americans in mind when he wrote. Okay, I want to repeat that in case you heard it the first time. No biblical writer had modern Americans in mind when he wrote. The converse is likewise true. All too few Americans have ancient Palestinian peasants in mind when they read the Bible. As the psalmist noted long ago in Psalm 137, if you want to look it up, trying to sing the Lord's song in a strange land can be exceedingly difficult. Although our circumstances may be less traumatic than those of the psalmist, the Bible is now being subjected to conditions its authors did not only not anticipate, but probably couldn't have understood if they had tried. Reading the Bible in this strange land to which it was never addressed can be difficult indeed. A Mediterranean Bible and a Western world have less in common than we have heretofore perceived. So now we have a lesson, and I want to read this. This comes from the biblical text of Luke 8, 26 through 39. And we need to keep the distance between ourselves and the first century in mind as we look at this story. It's talking about Jesus and the disciples. It says, then they arrived at the country of the Gerasenes, which is opposite Galilee. As he stepped out on the land, that is Jesus, a man of the city who had demons met him. For a long time he had worn no clothes, and he did not live in a house, but in the tombs. When he saw Jesus, he fell down before him, and he shouted at the top of his voice, which I am not going to do. Whatever you do to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God, I beg you, do not torment me. For Jesus had commanded the unclean spirit to come out of the man. For many times it had seized him, kept him under guard and bound. He was kept under guard and bound with chains and shackles. But he would break the bonds and be driven by the demon into the wilds. Jesus then asked, what is your name? And he said, Legion. For many demons had entered him. Legion is a Roman description of 1,000. They begged him not to order them to go back into the abyss. Now there on the hillside, a large herd of swine was feeding, and the demons begged Jesus to let them enter these. So he gave them permission. Then the demons came out of the man and entered the swine, and the herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake and was drowned. When the swineherd saw what had happened, they ran off and told it in the city and in the country. Then people came out to see what had happened, and when they came to Jesus, they found the man from whom the demons had gone, sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. Those who had seen it told them how the one who had been possessed by the demons had been healed, and all of the people of the surrounding country of the Gerasenes asked Jesus to leave them, for they were seized with great fear. So Jesus got in the boat and returned. The man from whom the demons had gone begged that he might be with him. But Jesus sent him away, saying, "Return to your home and declare how much God has done for you." So he went away, proclaiming throughout the city how much Jesus had done for him. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
So, when we acknowledge the distance between the time of Jesus and our time, it doesn't mean that Jesus' message is any less important. It just means there's certain things that we need to acknowledge before we try to stand under or understand what Jesus' message is for us. And I want us today, I'm going to ask you to do something special. Pay particular attention today and try to imagine what it is that I am trying to say. Over the last several weeks, and this is not only at annual conference, although it has a lot of annual conference, and on television, I've heard people, so-called biblical interpreters, try to jam what the Bible said 2,000 years ago into our particular circumstance for today. We're talking about a gap of at least 2,000 years. They've tried to explain women's social location, kind of talking out of both sides of their mouth. On the one hand, they say the woman's place is in the kitchen, or at least in the home. And on the other hand, they say women are human beings like everybody else, like that's some kind of big revelation, and they should have all the rights and privileges thereof. They should even be able to vote. Which, really, when you think about it, didn't happen until relatively rather recently. Think about Elizabeth Shepherd. When she was born, that was just about the time that women got the vote. So that shows you a little bit about how long her life spanned or how recently women got the right to vote. It's important to say here that the Bible speaks to a specific group of people at a specific time, located in a specific social circumstance. It's not just some big generic thing, but it was two specific people in a specific circumstance. What this means is the Bible can apparently do a lot of different things. One thing is that it can advocate for slavery, and on the other hand, we say that slavery is wrong. Today is Juneteenth. I don't know if that really means much to you, but it's an important day. It was Bishop Russell's birthday, so every year at annual conference, we got a little speech about how it was his birthday and Juneteenth on the same day and how important that was. Wasn't sure which one he was actually emphasizing, but he was my favorite bishop, so I always remembered that. But slavery was a social institution in the ancient world that nobody questioned. I mean, it was just, it came along part and parcel with being alive in those days. Now, today, we look at people in a different way than we did 2,000 years ago. But I also want to say we should not castigate the biblical writers because they lived in a time where oppression of women, slaves, other kinds of people was prevalent, because that's just the world that they lived in. I can't imagine 2,000 years from now people looking at what we believe think that what we believe is okay. Because in a lot of cases, it's really not okay. All this means is that the Bible probably needs to be interpreted for our world today, because we live in a different world. In the biblical times, people would go to war for grazing rights, where their sheep or goats or camels or, you know, whatever they had, where they could eat grass. People would go to war over such a thing. Now we live in a world in which Pakistan or India or North Korea could accidentally blow up Texas one day. Just, this is like the cosmic whoops. Somebody pushed the wrong button at the wrong time. So, Jesus and his disciples arrive in Gerasa, a city which is 20 miles to the east of the Jordan River in Gentile territory. And the ancient ideas that people had about folks, about demons and things like that, probably are the kinds of things that now we send people to psychiatrists or psychologists or neurologists for today. Now, I'm going to say something about shootings right now. This is not against people having guns. I'm just saying that this is sort of a full circle thing, because there are people that say that people that shoot elementary school children have some kind of mental disease or mental defect. That is why they do it. And in these days, when do you remember the story that I just read a minute ago? The guy ran around naked, and he also broke out of his chains and so forth. He seemed sort of like a menace. And they said, why did he do this? Because he had a demon, which meant he maybe had dementia, he maybe had schizophrenia, he had some kind of mental defect. And so in that sense, we have come sort of full circle with this, because people do some pretty bad things in our culture today, and about the only way you can explain it is to say that they are mentally defective. Demons in the ancient world were considered evil, and they fought, people thought that they did battle with legion, which a thousand things. People in Jesus' time believed that these demons invaded a human being and made them kind of, well, unbalanced, and that they might do things that you wouldn't normally expect people to do. Sometimes it drove these persons into the desert, and oftentimes they were shackled to protect themselves from themselves, but also to protect other people. I've been in churches where I thought we should chapel a few of the children. But for some reason, I was told that that was illegal. Jesus healed this man by his word. He said, demons come out. And so it changes the man's life in virtually every respect that it could. He went from living outside the city to living inside the city. He went from living in the tombs to being driven into the desert to then living in a house. He went from being naked to being clothed, from being demented to having a sound mind. These are sweeping changes that are effected simply because Jesus said, come out, and the demons came out. Now here is my question about this particular text. What did y'all pay attention to that lesson? I know that you just hear it once, and you know you pay me to study it every day, which I usually do, but I lost my Bible, so this is Methodist Church, only have one Bible here in the building. But notice what happens in this text. Nobody rejoices that this demented man has been healed. Did you notice that? Did you notice what their reaction was? It says it twice in the text, and I emphasized both times. They were full of fear, or they were terrified. You know, when I got sick and then I got well, I noticed that nobody was particularly terrified of me. It kind of made me mad. I wanted everyone to be terrified. But they weren't. We don't react that way. Somebody says, you're cancer free. People don't go, oh no. No, they're happy. They hug each other. They kiss each other. They do all that stuff that people do when they're happy. You know, if it happens. Nobody in this text was happy or rejoiced or hugging or kissing or doing any of that stuff. He's obviously a very scary person. But Luke tells us he's unclothed, lives in tombs, and was kept under guard and bound in chains and shackles. He would break his bonds and be driven by the demon into the wilds. This is the kind of person who strikes terror into every mother in the country of the Gerasenes. Do y'all have a neighborhood watch group? We're all kind of in the same neighborhood, I guess. Robin, can I tell them about those cameras that click on everybody's license plate, or do you want me to not say anything? Hey, you're law enforcement. You have the authority. We here in Salado, Texas, in the village, have these cameras. They're license scanners. So when some undesirable drives into town, we get a picture of their license plate. And Raleigh, I don't know who it is that keeps calling me and asking me what I'm doing here. They'd like for you to ask me to stop.
It's only stolen cars, stolen stuff, things like that that are...
I keep my receipt in my vehicle.
It's not just everybody.
But my neighborhood watch group would keep an eye out for such a person like this. Because we are afraid. I mean, I, you know, now that I'm a little older and I you know, can't be really brave and make a run for it. I just noticed that I'm kind of wary about people. You know, it's really embarrassing to ask somebody if they're there to harm you, and they say, I'm a sales clerk in this store. So the answer is yes, they're doing economic harm. But here's this neighborhood. The people see this naked, bound, crazed man, and all of a sudden, he's sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind. Why did they not rejoice, and why were they still afraid? And I have two answers to this question. You may not find them palatable, but I did, and so. The first reason that they don't rejoice is an economic reason. The powers that be saw this herd of swine go into the lake, and they, I'm sure, counted their economic losses. I don't know how many of y'all would pick farmers. By the looks of you, I'd say probably very few, but my grandfather raised hogs up in Missouri, and those things, they bring some money when you take them to market, or they used to. Cattle are the same way. We have people here that raise cattle. And so when these swine, when these hogs, these pigs, ran into the lake to drown themselves because they were filled with the man's demons, somebody lost some money. And my guess is that that may be one reason that they were not rejoicing that the man was healed. Now, do I need to tell any of you that economics plays a role in just about everything that we do? If you want to just scare yourself to death, just go turn on the news right now. Stock market, gas prices, housing prices, and all that kind of stuff. I mean, it's just, it's amazing how it can scare you to death. Most of us judge everything maybe on several different levels, but one level is we judge them by economics. Remember Fred Craddock saying, every human being that walks out of his or her house has three questions in mind. Will it be fun? Will my friends be there? Will I make any money? Those are the three questions that we ask ourselves when we participate in any kind of activity. That's why I was never in the PTA. I knew my friends wouldn't be there. I knew I wouldn't make any money. And I was pretty sure it wasn't going to be all that much fun. But I've repented, because now I'm going to join the PTA in September, in case any of you were worried. The second question is, why did they not rejoice, and why were they afraid? Has that question occurred to any of y'all? If you cooperate with me right now, I'll let you go. It was simply this. We've got 2 minutes until 10, so I need to finish. It was because the power that Jesus displayed, nobody watching could understand. And we are often afraid of the things that we can't understand. That is the truth. And what God has given us in Jesus is a mechanism to overcome fear. And What we call that mechanism is faith. It is by faith and for faith that we are able to overcome the fear that we have about things. Perfect love casts out fear, and the way you get to perfect love is by having faith that overcomes. So, Kierkegaard called it this, and it's what we understand as the leap of faith, and that's what we are asked to do. Now, as I said last week or the week before, I have many other things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. Let's pray. Gracious God, as you dismiss us with your peace, with your care, your concern, and cover us with the blessings of God Almighty. We pray this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Now we have a final hymn this morning. If there's someone that would like to renew his or her faith, or if you would like to join this particular United Methodist Church, I invite you to come forward as we stand and sing Near to the Heart of God, verses 1 through 3. Please sing.
There is a place of quiet rest near to the heart of God, a place where sin cannot dwell, near to the heart of God. Oh, Jesus, blessed Redeemer, send from the heart of God. Hold us awake before thee, near to the heart of God. There is a place of comfort sweet, near to the heart of God. A place where we our Savior meet, near to the heart of God.